Thank you, Kenzie.
It's great to be here. I'm Alondo Jones, an African-American man, brown-skinned, buzz-cut, with beard, salt and pepper, and a burgundy shirt.
My name is Andre M. Zachary. I identify as an African-American male, brown-skinned. Today, I'm wearing a black hat that says Clever on the logo. I'm also wearing a black sweater, and behind me is a white wall. Out in that for land acknowledgement, I am currently coming to you from Jersey City in the Clever Studios, which is on the unceded land of the Lenape and Wappinger people. So thank you, and it's great to be in the session today.
All right, so I'm going to share my screen. I see a couple familiar faces, which is always nice. Larry, haven't seen this guy in forever. It's wild. All right, let me share my screen. All right, so welcome to Best Practices in Marketing for Artists in a Virtual World. All right, so I'm just going to give you a little bit of my and Andre's background, and then we're going to cover some marketing essentials. I'm going to give you a lot of big picture examples of what you should be taking into consideration in your marketing efforts and show you a few case studies. And then Andre, who is currently a practicing artist, we'll show you some work that he's done recently, residencies and fellowships that have prepared him to be a more effective marketer, and also some tools that he's currently using to market his programs. And then we'll have some time at the end for Q&A. And before we dive in, I also want to say, I wanted to make sure in our development of this presentation that we're making sure that people that aren't so digitally savvy are getting some of the fundamentals. So for those of you that are already experts, please, you know, hang on with us and save your questions until the end, and we can give you some feedback or answer questions based on your specific goals. All right, so my name is Milando Jones. Like Kenzie said, I'm the Communications and Resources Manager at the Roundtable. I'm a New York native. And I'm also a visual artist. I earned an MFA in Fine Arts from the School of Visual Arts. I'm a painter, and I went to undergrad at Morehouse College in Atlanta, Georgia for business administration with a concentration in marketing. I've worked with a ton of arts organizations in New York City and across the country, but I've worked at Queens Council on the Arts, Fractured Atlas. I've probably sat on a dozen panels from the Museum of Art and Design to Brooklyn Arts Council, Bryant Park Corporation. I managed the Sukasa Artist in Residence Program for several years. So a large part of my background is not only as a visual artist, but also behind the veil at some of these institutions that are helping to fund and promote artists. So I'm happy to be here and to share some of my insight into how some of this works.
So as Kenji also introduced, my name is Andre M. Zachary. I am the artistic director and founder of Renegade Performance Group, which was founded in 2007. I currently still make work as an interdisciplinary artist working across mediums of dance and performance, site-specific work, and through film and technology. I've been in New York since 2002, receiving my BFA from the A.D. Fordham University program, and then my master in fine arts in performance and interactive media arts from Brooklyn College of the City University of New York. Like Milando, I've also sat on grant panels and selection committees, ranging from the Brooklyn Arts Council to the National Endowment for the Arts at the NEA. I've worked as a guest faculty at universities across the country, including Florida State University, Virginia Commonwealth, UCLA, and the Ohio State University. Before that, I also was a New York City teaching artist and arts educator from about 2008 to 2012, 2013. So I'm hoping to share as much of my experience and the work I'm still doing and practicing today with all of you, and hopefully we can answer as many questions as possible.
All right, so we're going to dive into some marketing essentials. All right, so I'm going to go through several things, but we're going to cover website design, different types of media and content, a few apps that you can also take advantage of, and some best practices in social media. All right, so the place where you want to start as you're trying to figure out, you know, how you're going to promote yourself and market yourself as an artist is, one, ask yourself, what are your goals, right? You know, because everyone has a different goal. Like, someone might be looking for a job. Another person might be trying to sell tickets to an event. Someone else might be trying to just get studio visits. Someone might be trying to sell their art. So figure out what your goals are, and then you can reverse engineer what your marketing strategy should be to accomplish those goals. Two, who is your target audience? You know, this can be several people from multiple demographics, but figuring out, you know, is your target audience potential employees? Are they curators? Are they buyers or collectors of work? Is it just trying to expand your general fan base? Determining who your target audience is will allow you to promote yourself more effectively as an artist. Where does your target audience live? So are they on Facebook? Are they on Instagram or Twitter? Are they on LinkedIn? Are they not on social media at all and respond well to email marketing? Or are they listening to podcasts? So figuring out where your target audience is, it helps you to not waste time promoting yourself in spaces where you shouldn't be. What type of content does your target audience respond to? This one's very important because as artists, we have the type of art and the type of media that we enjoy the most, and we put it out in the world as if everyone should appreciate it on the same level as we do. But the goal to reaching your audiences and engaging them is to make sure you're giving them the type of content that they're interested in. So is that sharing photos of your work? Is it showing behind the scenes videos of your creative process? Is it more like your general lifestyle? People don't care about your process and they'll buy your work because you show them all of your travel videos. You know, figuring out what is it that people are most engaged by when it comes to your work will be really important in establishing your long-term and short-term marketing strategy. And then what do most people do in your sector to promote themselves? You know, there's something to be said for, you know, fresh ideas, but since no idea is original, it makes sense to study who in your sector that's doing similar work, is doing online promotion and digital marketing of themselves in a great way. That way you have sort of a benchmark for what works and what doesn't work. And you can always put your twist and your flavor and style on some of these best practices. But it's a great thing to do is to look at your peers who are doing marketing work at a high level and taking notes. All right, so I'm going to go through website development, offer you some tools, video production, show you a few videos as case study examples, show you an example of what you can do with some audio, give you some best practices in social media, and a quick blog example. All right, so for websites, I find myself surprised how many artists are out there that still don't have a website. If you don't have a website, you should create one. And, you know, one thing for those of us who are like older than 30, we remember a time when websites were very expensive to have made and you couldn't make it yourself. You had to hire someone and you had to pay them to manage it. But now there are all of these resources online where you can pretty easily create your own website. It may not have all of the bells and whistles that come with having a custom-made site or someone who actually knows how to code, but you can go and online and find resources to make at least a basic website presence for yourself. And when it comes to seeking out new opportunities or jobs, you're just taken more seriously when someone can Google you and find that you have a website with your work that's, you know, ready for public viewing. And I just made this note, if you can create a Facebook album, you probably can create your own website. You know, there are so many people who are technologically challenged and they feel daunted by the idea of creating their own website. But at this stage, most people can at least get on Facebook and they know how to move images around. They know how to organize images and edit them. They know how to create basic captions. So if you can do that, you can actually take advantage of some of these website template platforms and develop your own website. I mean, then the last note here is to view your website as a visual resume. So you can actually have your resume on your website, but what you want to do is look at your website as a way to visually show the things that you're sharing on your resume and to give some context to what's in your resume. You know, when it comes to crafting a good resume, you're supposed to make it just salient enough to get the job, and then give more context based on your resume in the interview. But actually having a website and having visual identity attached to your resume will just help you increase your odds of getting that first call or that first interview or that first sale. Like I said, it all depends on what your goals are in terms of what strategy goes into developing your website. So just a few website resources that you should check out. There's Weebly, Wix, Squarespace, and GoDaddy. I have a few screenshots here. So Weebly is one of the few website templates that I know of, and there are so many that are developing, you know, week to week, month to month. But Weebly is one of the longer standing website template platforms where you can design a website for free. The difference between Weebly and some of the other platforms with allowing you to design a website for free is you can't plug in your domain name with the free option, but you can have a website up where you can send someone a link and you can build it out with as many pages as you'd like, just like you've paid for a website. And I just wanted you to see the pricing options here. You know, so the free basic use for $0, that's the one where you can't insert your domain name. And then you have a variety of other options based on how many pages or how much data you're using, or if you're going to have an e-commerce platform on your website. Then there's Wix. Almost everyone knows Wix. They used to have a free website option. They don't any longer. But the thing that makes Wix special is that I think they have the most website templates out of any of these like popular services. So you can like be on there for days just scrolling through site after site looking for a template that fits your goals and your aesthetic. I haven't used Wix for a while, but it's one of the first platforms that I learned how to build websites on. So I had to shout out Wix. And I've been to some Wix professional development workshops in Chelsea as well when they used to have an office there. So this is a website development platform that I love and use the most. This is Squarespace. So Squarespace doesn't have as many template design options as Wix or even Weebly. But what I like about Squarespace is it has more of a minimalist modern design aesthetic, and you can actually more easily play around with code and changing the backend part of it if you have any experience in code at all. You don't need to have experience in code with Squarespace. I just want to make that clear so no one runs away afraid of going to Squarespace. But because they have fewer templates, some people, you know, would prefer to go to Wix, but you can customize a Squarespace designed website in ways that the average person wouldn't know it's a Squarespace designed website. And here's the pricing structure for Squarespace. I probably have three websites. I've worked in Squarespace, Wix, WordPress, HubSpot. So I've designed across several different platforms, but I have three websites that are currently live that are designed in Squarespace. I'm actually going to stop sharing now so that I can show you an example. So this is a website project that I worked on as part of a collaboration about 3 years ago, fit the description. This site's goal was to highlight the relationship between Black male police officers and Black men in the community. It feels like super timely these days, but this was a really awesome project and a collaborative effort. And this is a website that was designed in Squarespace. So if you go on the Squarespace website, so looking at this landing page, you can't like do this like automatically out of the template. You do have to manipulate some code in order to just get the text to fit center screen this way. But I just wanted to show you an example of what's possible in Squarespace. Here's another website that my team and I designed. This is for the Rhode Island Writers Colony. This is based out of Warren, Rhode Island. It's a residency program for writers of color. If any of you guys know Jason Reynolds, the super famous young adult fiction author, he was one of the first writers in residence in this program. That's him on screen now, and he's the current artistic director for this program. Here, you know, you see you can have video moving on your landing page banner. We have pictures of some of the artists and residents who participated in the program. And then we have a short video here that shows, it's a sizzle reel from one of the readings from the artists and residents. One more quick example. So this was designed in GoDaddy, actually. So for those of you who do have domain names and got your domain name from GoDaddy, they do have options where you can design a website through their site. They don't have lots of options, but they have some cool ones. And this was a project that I worked on earlier this year under the leadership of Margaret Rose Vendrees, who is a really amazing artist, art historian, and the department chair of fine art at York College in Jamaica, Queens, my old neighborhood. And we worked together for about 6 months recruiting artists and curating this show, the second Southeast Queens Biennial. So I can just scroll through here. And this website is a single scroll. So the other websites had multiple pages. This one, we built it out so that all of the content that you'd glean from the page, the website is on one page. Just so you can see what's possible. All right. Jump back into the presentation. All right, so video. All right, so video these days, it's like more important than ever. You know, we're on video every day. We're producing video on a regular basis. Video has become central to all of our lives. But specifically when it comes to marketing yourself, there are some key things that I found that people look for or people are most engaged by. One, it's documenting your creative process. If you think about it, for most of us who are artists, most people want to know like what your creative process is like. What's your studio process like? So the more that you can share that and demystify the process with video, the more you're going to have engaged people looking at your work. Share your journey or your areas of expertise. You know, most of us as artists, especially New York City-based artists, we sometimes underestimate the value of the knowledge that we've acquired. And we don't like put ourselves out there. And sometimes we struggle with looking at ourselves as experts in the industries that we work in. So I encourage those of you out there who, you know, aren't so camera shy to actually get on camera and talk about, you know, what it is that you know and your experiences, because opportunities can sometimes be gleaned just from people looking at you as a thought expert in your field. Create visual experiences that viewers can connect to. I sort of spoke to this earlier. Sometimes, you know, people really just want to escape through, you know, just like if, you know, when you're Netflixing and chilling and you're binge watching on TV, like people want to look at their peers to live vicariously through them as well. So sometimes it's as simple as like bringing people into your world and creating content that makes people feel more connected to you. And then that way you're sort of removing barriers when it comes to sharing your work or sharing your resources with them. So I wanted to just show you really quickly, this is a 1 minute sizzle reel. So this is from, my agency studio in Jersey City. It's where Andre is currently. I'm sheltering in place with my family down south right now. But I wanted to share this video with you because one of the things that, you know, helps with the Clever Agency is like people are always asking for clarity around what we do, because I'm like, hey, we're a full service agency. We do design, we do video production, we do marketing. And we work with artists and we work with nonprofits. So I actually wanted to bring people into the studio with this short video. And this is something that we did on a with a mix of cell phone cameras, actual Canons, Sony. So even if you're limited in your access to technology, you can do something like this with your phone. All right, 1 minute. If you come to the website, something that's, you know, not so long where, you know, you start to fall asleep, but just enough to give you some of the experience of what it's like with collaborating with artists in the Clever Studio. Sorry, next slide. All right, so I wanted to share a couple quick apps that are my go-to apps. InShot. It's not like the most popular app, but I've had this app for a couple years. I really love it. InShot does both photo editing and video editing. Usually apps only give you one option or the other. And some are better at video editing or better at photo editing, but I really like InShot. It's sort of like my one shop stop for editing something on the go. So you literally can edit a whole short film using this app. And you can do color correction and all that good stuff, and even drop in text. It's a really great app to work with. For those of you who are familiar with the GoPro camera, GoPro actually has an awesome app as well for video editing. There are certain editing tools in there that are a little more advanced that you can pay for, but it is a free app and you can get like basic editing done in GoPro. And I like it because it offers some animated title slide options that you don't find everywhere. For those of you who are not familiar with Canva, I feel like Canva's really blown up in the past year in terms of its notoriety, but Canva is a really awesome resource for those of you who have no Adobe Creative Suite, Adobe Photoshop Illustrator skills, but want to do some like cool design work. You can learn how to use Canva, you know, in under an hour if you just, you know, spend a little time on there or watch a YouTube tutorial. Really user-friendly platform for people who want to do design work. And, you know, you can use Canva to create thumbnails for your videos, cool assets for your social media. I really like Canva a lot. And I know Adobe Creative Suite like the back of my hand, but Canva's like that quick go-to. If I'm on the go, if I'm on someone's computer that doesn't have Adobe Creative Cloud, I can just get on Canva and whip something up design-wise really quickly. Audio production, podcasting. So one of the biggest things trending right now online is the podcasting industry. It's a $1 billion industry right now. I'm sure a lot of you heard about Joe Rogan with his $100 million Spotify deal. You know, podcasting was like this thing like weirdos did a couple years ago, and now it's a central form of media in our lives. And so it's something I have a minimal personal experience in, but I've worked on podcast productions for clients. And just a couple quick tips on podcasting for those of you who are interested. You can always start with video and then extract audio from the video. And that way you're killing two birds with one stone, and you actually are producing multiple forms of media in one shot. And then a step up, you can also use services like rev.com. I don't have a slide up for that, but for those of you who take note, rev.com is a site that you can use to take audio and transcribe it into text. And then you can use that text for your blog writing or for subtitles as you're captioning your videos. And if you do want to produce, use audio to produce your own podcast, you can use, I'm a Mac guy, I'm sorry, I don't have a PC equivalent, but you can use a simple program like GarageBand to actually edit a podcast in a short period of time. And SoundCloud is probably one of the oldest go-to sites that you can use to upload your podcast for the first time, even though there are now probably a dozen podcast sites and services that are more popular than SoundCloud. I was going to show you a couple more examples, but now I'm eating into Andre's part, so I'm sort of going to speed through here. So some social media best practices. And I compiled this list of bullets from like frequently asked questions when I do these sorts of workshops. So one of the most important things with social media is you have to be consistent. If you're like me, like outside of work, I'm not on social media a lot, right? So, but if you want to engage your folks, it's all about setting their expectations with some consistency. So does that mean you're just going to do one post a week, or, you know, one post bi-weekly, or you're going to do one post a week every Wednesday? People are going to go to your feed or go to your page because they know on Wednesday at 12 o'clock, Kenzie's going to drop a new Instagram story, you know? So it's like figuring out what's a good rhythm for you to post on social media so that you're consistent in the expectations that you build with your followers. Pick your platforms. I spoke to this a little earlier in brief, but you don't have to be on every social media platform. You know, there are people who are super successful on Instagram and have a million followers, but they only have 100 followers on YouTube. You know, so it really doesn't, it's not necessary for you to spread yourself so thin that you're worrying about juggling your presence on multiple social media platforms. Just think about one, first off, where are you the most comfortable, or what social media platform do you enjoy the most? And then are the people that you're targeting there? And then how do you engage them? Paid social media. If you're like me and like the average person, the idea of like paying to promote yourself on social media sounds like horrible. But depending on what your goals are, paying for social media will move the needle on your goals. And I want to actually put it in perspective. Like before, like the past couple years, none of the major companies were consistently advertising on social media. And now social media advertising is such a big thing. Of course, that was something that, you know, the people at Facebook and all of those guys constructed as well. But where I'm going is in 5 years, 10 years, when these major corporations like Coca-Cola or Mercedes-Benz or all these people who have like millions of dollars that they're putting into halftime commercials, when they say, you know what, I'm going to take this $1 million off of the halftime commercial and I'm going to use it for paying on social media advertising, because that's where 70% of my people are anyway. What that's going to do for folks like you and me is make buying advertising space on social media completely inaccessible. So we're now probably in the last few years of actually being able to purchase ad space on social media. And, you know, you can do some research. If you just think about the early days of advertising on TV or the early days of advertising on radio, it used to be dirt cheap. And now it's completely inaccessible by the average Joe. So just some context, take advantage of paid social media when you can. Follow the people on social media that you want to work with and engage their content. You know, one question I get a lot is like, how do I get in front of people? Like, how do I get shows? How do I get opportunities? And before COVID, it used to be, you go to every opening reception, you go to this person's performance, you make sure you show up, you introduce yourself, you show support for that institution or for that person or collective before you make an ask. You know, you put in, you know, you put two steps forward in hopes that there's some reciprocity down the line. Now, you know, we're all cut off from one another. So the only space that we have is the virtual realm to connect with one another. So for those curators, artists, collectors that you really want to connect with, follow them, like their content, comment on their content. Once you've developed a relationship, maybe you go slide into the DMs and ask them for a studio visit or ask them to give their opinion on this new work that you've produced. Create sacred hashtags. Lots of people look for content online by using hashtags, whether it's your location or the type of work that you're doing. I know like one of Andre's popular hashtags is Afrofuturism. He works in that creative space a lot. And so he's going to pop up if you scroll long enough, if you type in Afrofuturism. So whatever your lane is or whatever your city is, you know, create hashtags that you use for every single post so that you begin to populate under that hashtag. Engagement over likes and followers. It's much more important that people are actually engaging your content, commenting on your content, sharing it, converting, meaning like, you know, they're purchasing work or they're buying a ticket, than it is for you to have a million likes or a million followers. You know, I know influencers who have 10 times more followers than I have, but they're not selling their events out, or they're not selling work. So it's more important to engage people and make real connections than it is to build this massive follower movement. Then create content for your feed and for your stories. Now that stories are on all of the major social media platforms, some people aren't even scrolling through their feeds as much anymore, and they're just swiping their stories. So make sure those things that you want people to have eyes on, you're putting in your stories as well, even if it's the exact same content that's in your feed, just to make sure people don't miss it. And on that note, I'm going to pass it to Andre.
Thanks so much, Milando, for leading us in. So I'm going to get a little bit more specific on the practices that I'm doing as a working artist and also a teaching artist and educator. So we can move forward into this next slide. So we'll look at five areas: case studies, artist professional development, residencies and fellowships, outreach and communications, and various tools and technologies that you can use specifically for your own work and your own practice. So we can move into case studies. So most recently, I was commissioned, and then I also self-created some dance films. So in the situation that we are in right now, yes, almost all of our work is going to have to be connected virtually. So whether that is text, whether that's video, or whether that's sound, and soon also to be, I also believe, augmented reality, if anybody is working in that realm, or even virtual reality. But essentially that is the space in which we are all literally meeting, joining, and sharing ideas. And so I was commissioned by the CUNY Dance Initiative and the Queens Public Library to create a film or a response to encourage New York City participant, New York City residents to participate in the 2020 census. So we can take a look at this film really quickly, an excerpt from it. So this was done this past September. This is actually from Governor's Island, where I'm currently a resident artist through Lower Manhattan Community Council, LMCC. We're gonna get to the residencies and spaces a little bit later. So this is one example of work. We can move to the next slide. Ah, perfect. So this is actually talking about the tools that Milando was mentioning earlier. So I actually am an artist that, as a choreographer, I also shoot with camera, mainly DSLR. I can also shoot with film, but I also edit video and edit sound as well. For this project, I knew I needed to get it out quickly, so I used iMovie, which is a standard application on all Mac. All Mac systems. So whether you have a MacBook or a Mac Tower, you will have iMovie as a visual and movie editing program. So here we can see how I edited the film. This is an example of a workspace window. This is literally just a screenshot, but this is a program that is very simple to use. It's very user-friendly. And from using iMovie, you can then progress and to start more complicated projects in Adobe Premiere and also Final Cut. And we can come back to that a little bit later as well. So this is an example of kind of the back-end work of how this film was made. Okay, we can move on. This was another independent project I did in collaboration with the same singer-songwriter and Maya. And so we did this in response to Dance the Vote. And so we can look at this project really quickly called Red Line.
Get up on your feet and change what you see. We don't need no crowds, no picket signs, just follow me. Get up off your seat and change what you see. You don't need no signs, no marching shoes, just follow me. Kick, paw, change into the darkness, don't be afraid what you see. Won't come out until we're righteous. Time to change up the beat. We've been dancing a red line. Anger's running in the streets.
So this is Red Line, and this is in Bedford-Stuyvesant, Brooklyn, on the Black Lives Matter mural, as you can clearly see, or if you cannot see. The cinematographer was the same person, a good friend of mine, Richard Lusant. This goes back to what Milando was saying earlier. It's often about building relationships. I've worked with Richard Lusant, who is a Queens-based cinematographer and filmmaker for many years. So he and I have a really great relationship as well with the singer-songwriter Aaron Maya. And so in building the project, I was able to call and email and kind of arrange really quickly. And I kind of was able to take advantage of what the city is offering right now. And so Aaron had this idea to create something that for this new song, and that was also encouraging voter participation. And this is kind of what we came up with. And I'm was really proud about this project as well. I also edited this project. So that's the thing, learning these skills, it it saves you literally time and money. So on the front end, taking the time and money and resources to learn these skills is incredibly important. We can go to the next slide.
Her face and tell her she'd say, baby, grandma, understand that you really love that man. Put yourself in Jesus' hands, grandma's hands.
Have you ever worn the mask?
So that was Just Pass and Beyond, a dance film I created really early in lockdown. And it was commissioned by 19 Acts of COVID Bravery that became an online virtual performance gallery. This is literally on my fire escape, and that's my wife who's performing, Candace Thompson Zachary. And again, I was able to use the resources that I had, the costuming and the idea and even the setup, and kind of create a film, kind of my take, an Afrofuturist kind of response to where we are right now in the midst of this, very trying circumstance. We can get to that a little bit later. We can go to the next, I think we can skip over these next two. And we can, so we can have enough time, because I don't want to make sure that I'll send you guys to my website so you can see the rest. These are some specific projects that I've created, Untamed Space and Sia, but I want to get through some more things in a second. So residencies and fellowships. And this also goes into, I believe, and this also starts to include artist development as well. So I'm currently a resident artist at Governors Island Art Space through Lower Manhattan Community Council. So every borough has an arts council. So I live in Brooklyn, New York, and so when I apply for grants or even also teaching artists opportunities, I can find them through the Brooklyn Arts Council. The Lower Manhattan Community Cultural Council is representative usually of all of Manhattan. Then there's Queens Council for the Arts, QCA, that Milando's worked for. Then there's the Bronx Arts Council, the BX Arts Council. There's the Staten Island Cultural Art. I might not be getting that correct. And so all five boroughs have arts councils that provide resources, advocacy tools, teaching artists opportunities. Get to know your arts council. It's very helpful. They have also very robust professional development opportunities that extend now kind of like yearly with online programming. And I'm pretty sure that that's going to definitely just continue. So once we're able to come back in person, I can pretty much guarantee you that, much like we're on now, this artist development is going to continue throughout calendar years, which will be incredibly important and also kind of unlock accessibility for various people. You can go to the next slide. This is an artistic residency that I was a part of, Critical Breaks Residency at High Arts. High Arts started as the Hip Hop Theater and Arts Festival. They're currently located in El Barrio Arts Space on 99th Street, on the upper East Side, really Spanish Harlem, East Harlem, on 99th between 2nd and 3rd Avenue. The Critical Breaks Residency was a period for about 4 weeks where I was able to develop in collaboration with another artist, Lamont Hamilton, our piece Dap Line, that we were getting ready to tour to the August Wilson Center in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. And this residency occurred in late 2018 and into early 2019. So this is an organization, and like other artistic organizations, they have art residency opportunities for artists that you should definitely look up. They also have teaching opportunities for artists as well that are a part of their outreach and programming agenda.
Hey, Andre, not to interrupt, but when you think about it, so the project that Andre worked on, the DAP Line project that he did with Lamont Hamilton, actually created an opportunity for Andre where he was brought in as a choreographer on The Five Bloods. If any of you've seen that with Chadwick Boseman on Netflix. So all of the dapping choreography, that's Andre.
Yeah, it's so that I did forget to mention that. So Lamont and I, we were able to fly out to Chiang Mai, Thailand, and choreograph and consult and create on location with the actors and with Spike Lee. It was kind of it was actually a really amazing experience. Spike literally, you know, was excited to see us, and then he kind of just like, you know, laid it down to the actors, like, you follow them. And it was like, whoa, okay. And so it was really an amazing experience. But I think this is an example of again, the building of the relationships and the doing the work. You can't really understate that. And so just, you know, taking the time to, you know, to engage in this way, it's paid dividends. Thanks Mo for that big up. University Settlement, and this is actually where DAP Line started, the performance piece. So University Settlement is an art space. It's actually one of the oldest and perhaps maybe one of the first specifically immigrant art spaces in the United States. I'm not quite sure about that, but it's an immigrant arts and cultural space that has existed since its inception on the Lower East Side. Thank you for the link, Kenzie. They have a residency called the Performance Project Residency, which Lamont Hamilton and I did apply for, which allowed us to build our piece DAP Line. They also have other services. They have youth programs as well. They have connections to other artistic institutions. So within your specific neighborhoods and within New York City, please begin to look at opportunities that you can possibly send your resume. Again, very easy then to just send them your website, a link to your website, and that's how relationships are built. And I still have a really great relationship with University Settlement as an art space and cultural institution. The New York Foundation for the Arts, so in relationship with NISCA. NISCA is essentially the Arts Council of New York State, and then the New York Foundation for the Arts, they are a little bit more specialized in that they help identify, they can help you identify funding opportunities specifically for your work. I am a recipient of a New York Foundation for the Arts fellowship in choreography in 2016, a Gregory Millard Fellow. If you go to NYFA, they have an immense array of programming and resources, as we can see in the link there, for people looking for job opportunities, funding opportunities, applications. NISCA has that statewide, not just New York City. So they are an incredibly important resource for you to look up and look into. The Jerome Hill Artist Fellow. So I am a recipient of a Jerome Hill Artist Fellowship. Which I received in 2019. I applied for that in early 2018. So I guess what does this mean is that the building of your website, the crafting of your social media, the drafting of your artist statement, the drafting of your teaching statement, all of that literally helps you refine and again, know who you are as an artist, as a teaching artist, and what you do and what you kind of plan to do with your work. So by the time you get to applications such as these, such as major fellowships or grants, such as the Jerome Hill Artist Fellowship, what you should be able to do is plug and play. And so meaning that from my bio, I literally just, because I have my bio saved in a Google Doc. Actually, funny enough, learning the Google Suite is also a very important task and thing you should do. So learning how to use Google Drive and other things, they're really great. But anyway, in a Google Sheet, I can literally just like paste that on my website and paste that in an application for a fellowship or a grant. I feel it should be that easy as an artist. It saves you time because therefore, I mean, you don't have time to draft a 200 word bio every application. Like it doesn't work. So what that means is you have to work on that constantly, and then you have to send it to your friends, send it to your community, get feedback. And then therefore, even my artist statement, I could just plug and play from my website to this application and just boom, boom. And so even project descriptions, you know, I'm thinking about that on the front end. So then by the time I have that for other applications, again, I just plug and play. If it's a word count, if I need to change some things, change the order, I'm able to do that literally then just, and so instead of like coming up with 500 words each time, it's already set. And that's literally why the practice of, because essentially the sharing that you're doing on social media, and I'll emphasize the word sharing, is important because you're getting feedback from the people who you want to reach. So it's not that you're boasting or it's an egotistical thing. No, you're really getting information, like someone could see or hear or read something that you never knew what was in your work, and that will help you. And essentially it has led to opportunities such as the Jerome Hill Artist Fellowship. Go to the next one. And here's the application, the website for the fellowship as well. Digital media, moving into that. So about connecting with your audience. So beyond social media, on a more personal level, you're sharing, so questions. Oh yes, I did, hey. Oh hey, how are you? I saw it in the chat. We'll get back, I'll get to you in a second. What's going on, Eleanor? Man, yeah, great to see you. Oh man. So more specifically, beyond social media, in a more direct and concise way of connecting with your audience, you're developing now more targeted reach. And so that's developing monthly or even quarterly communications via e-blast and digital newsletters. The platform I use is called MailChimp, and this is a screenshot of it here. There are other platforms such as Constant Contact, but for me, I like the aesthetic of MailChimp and what it's able to do. You can see the analytics, or basically the information or the data sets from your specific emails. And it's actually really important to read. I mean, essentially, reading this data is essentially what media firms all over the world are constantly doing. It's not necessarily that mysterious. You're just looking at these data points, and even you can even be more specific about like who and where you want to see. Yeah, so we can see here, I can look and say, oh, these are the top locations of people that open my work. And literally it's all right here in New York City, Brooklyn, Manhattan, and then the BX in the Bronx. I've asked other people as well. I'm like, hey, you know, I'm only getting about between 18 to like 20% of people that open newsletters. And most people say, yeah, I mean, that's true. I've talked with other firms. They're like, yeah, that's about average. I mean, sometimes they'll say like maybe for like other, I guess like larger companies or organizations, it's closer to like the 30 or even 20% range. So yeah, let's keep moving so we can make sure we get questions. So these are my respective social media accounts. On Facebook, I'm at Renegade, at RPG Brooklyn. On Instagram, I'm at Renegade PG, and on Twitter, I'm at Renegade PG as well. I'll make sure to put those handles in the chat for people to find. Cool, I think that's about it. I'll take you guys, before we do Q&A, I'll take you guys to my website really quickly so we can see. So this is my website, renegadepg.com. I've tried to be as engaging, as interactive as possible on my website. I also put up embedded a video to the Dance NYC Artists Are Necessary Workers campaign. And then finally, of course, we need support. We need funding for our work. That's incredibly important. So I put the donate button right there. Don't be ashamed about that. Make people give you money, make people support you. Like, literally, that's okay. Like, don't feel bad about that at all. You want people to engage with you. You want people to, you know, your work is important. You need it as an engine moving forward. Make it easy for people. I believe in that. More specifically, how do we get funding? So we haven't had a lot of time, and I can answer questions here. I am a fiscally sponsored artist, Renegade Performance Group is a fiscally sponsored artistic project of Fractured Atlas. That is, Fractured Atlas is a 501c3 organization that serves as an umbrella or host for myself and other companies, projects, and entities on an international level. So we'll go to the Fractured Atlas page here. So anyone that wants to donate or contribute, whether it's funding or even supplies and material on my behalf, the Renegade Performance Group, can go to Fractured Atlas and find me. The link is there. And I have various donation levels set that I wanted to see. You can do that. You can draft that with Fractured Atlas. And so what that means is it is a tax deductible donation for that person or that organization to donate to you. However, Fractured Atlas will take a percentage. I do believe it's between 6 or 8%. I can't remember at this time. And you also, to be a fiscally sponsored project, you have to also just, for Fractured Atlas, number one, it just has to be artistic. In some way, it just needs to be an art project. And then two, it is a $20 per month fee. Some organizations charge at different levels and offer different incentives at different rates. There's also the field. Other organizations, other 501c3s can become your fiscal sponsor. So almost most New York theater spaces are 501c3 nonprofit organizations. They could become your fiscal sponsor as well. So if anybody wants to address that a little bit later in the question answer period that we're going to start right now, we can talk about that. But I hope this has been very helpful to people. And thank you again, Kenzie, for hosting myself and Milando.
Oh, thank you both so much. I mean, wow, this has been so informative and so much information shared. And I'm sure I'm speaking for everyone on the call when I say how much we appreciate it. So I did save some questions that were already posted in the chat, but folks, please continue to post your questions in the chat. If you want to raise your hand, we can also have you come off of mute if you'd like to ask a question. I just want to go back really quickly. So while Milando was presenting, there were some great questions in the chat, and Andre was on top of it, and he answered them all in the chat. But there are a couple that I want to revisit in case people weren't reading, because I thought he gave some really great insight there. And then I'd love to hear from you both as well on any additional comments that you have. So one of the questions was, how important would you say creating a site is for a teaching artist, which is slightly different from an artist? And then going forward, there was some other discussion about what a teaching artist website content would be. And Andre, you shared a lot of really great insight on that. And so if you and Milando could expand on that, that would be great.
So I also have a history as a teaching artist. It was the majority of my work for a solid decade before I started the Clever Agency and got more into the digital media marketing side. And I totally had a teaching artist. I don't think I called it that. I think it was just education. So on my personal website, I had a page that was just for my work in arts education. So that would be just pictures behind the scenes of like me working with the kids and, you know, making sure I didn't show their faces. But, you know, I went into it strategically that way, like how can I capture the classroom experience and show that they're engaged without like getting in trouble. I also showed like finished artwork from my students. When I could, I did have a couple instances with one of the organizations that I work for where we got permission to show in this one specific class from specific kids and parents. We could share their images on our website. So those kids, I would show their work, or I'd have like little video clips with testimonials from them. So yeah, I don't think promoting yourself as a teaching artist is any different than any other discipline, you know? And because you're an artist, you're going to be able to do it in cool and creative ways. So even if you're not showing kids at all, or you're not showing your classroom at all, you could just put up galleries of your student work, you know, and that's going to be engaging in itself. That'll show your skill level and impact alone. Yeah.
Awesome. Thank you so much for that. There was also a couple of questions around blogging, if you guys don't mind expanding on that. So one of the questions was, should I have my blog on my website? Should it be something separate? Why or why not?
So there's no like 100% right or wrong answer. But if you're new to blogging, it makes sense to start with using it as content for your website. I'd also say, artists aren't in this space so much, but if you are interested in writing and sharing your writing, get on LinkedIn. People do engage long form pieces on LinkedIn more so than other social media platforms. Post your stuff on LinkedIn. And just because you have it on your website, it doesn't mean that it can't live on other platforms like LinkedIn's specific blog platform or Medium or whatever, you know, Huffington Post. I don't know if HuffPost is still around. I haven't read it anymore. But yeah, you can have it on your website and then you can put it in other places as well.
And I also have a blog specifically on Tumblr, but I'm able to embed my Tumblr onto my website. I can actually, I can show you really quickly if possible. Let me see if I can, yeah. So from here, I'm able to, so this is my Tumblr page, my Tumblr that I was able to take the embed code and then put into my website. And so we can see here, if I have very specific writings that I want to post, then I actually am able to share it on both platforms and it doesn't take away it. All it does is kind of extend the reach.
Okay, let me make sure I'm not missing any questions. So Sarah, if you have any insight on this, please share. And if anyone else on the call has insight on this, you can share it in the chat or come off it. Sarah has asked, how do you handle the legal part of posting student work? I contract as a teaching artist through different orgs that have their own rules. How do you get permission to post student work on your own website? I'll say from my experience, the organizations that I've worked for have had a permission form already for students, so I didn't have to deal with that personally. So check with the organizations that you're working for. Milando, Andre, do you have anything else to add?
Yeah, I think it varies by organization. You know, yeah. Some organizations are strict. Even if they do have permission to show the student's work, the individual teaching artist can't. And then some are like, you know, if it's in your class, you can actually share permissions, if you will. So yeah, it sort of varies. And I haven't taught kids in forever as well. The last several years that I've been a teaching artist, it's been with the older adult population through the Tsukasa Artist in Residence program. So I have had no issues sharing their work. So I might be out of the loop when it comes to what's current in the classroom for kids these days as well.
Yeah, let me take you to the, I worked as a teaching artist through 651 Arts, which is an arts organization in Brooklyn, New York. I can show you a project that we did with the students. So through the 651 Arts New Media and Arts Fellowship, we actually came up with the idea that the students that we were working with, the student artists who were in high school, they created an interview series with resident artists, professional resident artists of 651 Arts. And so they interviewed four artists. The first was Keisha Scarville, four, I believe. Keisha Scarville, Kyria Yvonne Traber, who's currently the curator at High Arts, Najee Ritter, and Maxine Montilus. And so from here, and I can put that link in the chat as well, essentially I assisted the students in learning how to operate camera, edit sound and video. The only thing I would change now is I would now make sure that we would create closed caption to make sure about accessibility. And this is an example. With the organization, 651 Arts was extremely happy that we started the YouTube channel. The other thing is that what was important is that, you know, many of these youth were able to use this on their university and college applications, which I thought was also cool as well. So I think, you know, within the organization, there's also ways in which, you know, your work also helps the students with their trajectory and moving forward as well. So again, it becomes a reciprocal relationship within whatever project or space that you're working in, hopefully.
Great. There was also a question in the chat regarding, Melinda, you had brought up Rev, which is a company that does a lot of things. You were talking about how they can separate sound and video, is that right?
So they transcribe audio
right.
from video.
So there was a question about if they translate as well. Do you happen to know? I'm looking on their website right now and it actually says they do foreign subtitles. So they will translate your video with foreign subtitles, but when it comes to a couple other things, I'm not exactly sure. But I'll also I just wanted to bring that up because Andre, you had just mentioned accessibility and using closed captions. Rev also offers very affordable captioning services. So that link, I'll pop it in the chat again. But if you're interested in adding captions to any of your videos, or they do live captions for Zoom as well, it's $20 per user a month. It's very affordable. I just wanted to add that resource in there. And I had one more question that I saved. There was a question around, I don't know if you went into it because I was typing out, Melinda, but you had mentioned sacred hashtags. Can you expand on that concept a little bit?
Yeah, sure. It's most people use hashtags sort of randomly, like they use them like based on where they are or how they're feeling. But if you're approaching it from like a marketing position, you want to have hashtags that are specific to you, your work, or your brand that you're using on everything that you put out. So I don't know. So say for Andre, his brand is Renegade Performance Group. His hashtag is, you know, Renegade, Be Renegade, Renegade PG. He puts that on everything. Brooklyn is part of his brand. Brooklyn's on everything. Afrofuturism is part of his brand. The Afrofuturism hashtag is on everything. So you can have, say, and I think, you know, it varies by platform, but you could have up to a couple dozen hashtags. I don't use that many, but you can have your core hashtags that you're using for everything that you're, basically consider the hashtags that you choose as part of your brand. And you're using those hashtags on every social media post. But then you can add hashtags that may not be part of your brand, but are more specific to the moment or the place or what have you. Does that help?
Yes, perfect, thank you. And Mega just put her question in the chat, which was my next one up, which is, how many of these opportunities, and that's in reference, Andre, to you were talking about fellowships and whatnot, are you seeing move to a virtual space? And she went on to say, meaning if I apply for some of these programs, but I'm not located in New York, are there organizations that are open to that?
Hmm. You know, that's a great question. I cannot answer that because that is really dependent on the specific institution in New York City. I can't say what's going to happen with that. That's a real crystal ball kind of question there. What I can say is that there are, and this might be actually opening up a little bit more, is the professional development and skill building. And so I'm going to take you guys to the BRIC website right now. And so BRIC offers media classes across a spectrum of topics and ranges, whether it's operating, learning how to use and operate camera, video editing, sound editing, field production with sound design. And you also, if you live in Brooklyn specifically, you're able to then start to rent equipment from BRIC for your specific projects. BRIC also has teaching artists that you can also become a BRIC teaching artist if you take some of the BRIC certificate courses. If you are a Brooklyn resident, most of these certificate courses are at a very subsidized rate. And so our tax dollars go to that. And so you can take a certificate course in TV film production for, I believe it's $50. So this is under $100 that you're learning how to use, professional grade equipment and in a professional television studio. It's worth it. You meet people and then you also get put on a list for being a production artist, and you can also then become a BRIC teaching artist. Again, you can use that to now pad your resume. So now when you're going out for your next opportunity, you now have this set of skills that's also certified from BRIC. 92nd Street Y also offers, there's a whole range of offerings from 92nd Street Y, but they have other classes as well. If you go to the 92nd Street Y, they have continuing education courses. And then finally, if you go to City University of New York, CUNY also has continuing education courses. I was able to take an HTML and Java course at BMCC. I think it was the summer of 2019, I believe I took that, or it might have, no, summer 2018. Look out for continuing education and professional development opportunities, because usually those are now expanded on more of a global level, and they'll connect you like across. So suddenly you'll realize that there'll be something in California that you can actually link to, and that might provide another opportunity. So I mean, it's highly worth doing the research and taking the time to take the course.
Thank you. Another question is regarding some equipment that you can get. So Andre, you were talking earlier about Milando, I think you showed a video that was shot on a phone, and that people can do this sort of work just with what they have now. But are there any other affordable tools that people can get themselves now to sort of upgrade those videos and their home art recording experiences?
Yeah, sure. Like one tool that I still could use some development in that Andre uses a lot is a gimbal. So say if you are shooting your video on a phone and you want to shoot things in motion. So if you want to shoot like man on the street sort of videos, or if you're a performing artist and you want to shoot yourself while you're moving, getting a gimbal so that you're getting like minimal shake in your video, it makes such a difference to the production quality. And you can get a phone gimbal for like $100, $125. It's not the same. No matter how good the stabilizer in your phone or your camera is, it's not the same when you add a gimbal to the mix.
I have two gimbals. I have one for my camera, like an actual, it's a Zoom Crane gimbal. but then I'm trying to find the one specifically for phones. Because I just got it, and it works really, really well. Where is it? If you go, let me just put in the, I'm just gonna put in the website, Adorama. So for these, for equipment such as this, which Milano's speaking about, the gimbal and other audio equipment, this is where you start to go to more specialty and specialized stores such as Adorama, which is I think on 18th Street still between 6th and 5th Avenue, and then also B&H Photo, which is on 34th Street. Then there's also for audio equipment, Sam Ask is also I think across the street from B&H on West 34th Street. It actually is worth it because, as Milano was saying, you know, podcasting, understanding how you it so much of it is about packaging your skill set, whether you want to call that a brand or whatever, but you've developed a specific philosophy and a pedagogy that engages people or engages community, and it's worth archiving that and it's worth preserving that, because essentially that's how it gets passed on, that's how it actually, you know, gets to impact on a broader level. And so learning how to and B&H, and even at the Apple store, they have tutorials, they have now online tutorials on how to use these equipment, and practice on your family, practice on friends or neighbors. I mean, you know, right now in a safe way, but an affordable camera to recommend, well, so DSLR cameras are now less expensive because now there are more mirrorless cameras. So it really depends on, I mean, I still say a good camera is worth it. A good camera and lens are very much worth the money. So you're gonna spend upwards of $500, upwards of $600 really.
I'd also say a great investment would be in a lapel mic as well, if you are doing video recording on camera, especially if there's any sort of significant distance between yourself and the camera. Having a wireless lav mic, it's pretty priceless. There's a brand called Saramonic, Saramonic, that tends to be more affordable than some of the other microphone brands if you're looking for something on a budget.
Also, someone just asked about setup. So I think it's worth, I'm gonna go to Logitech. They have webcams that I think are really worth, let's see, Logitech webcam. No, I'm here already, but where are the webcams that are really worth no, these are like cute. These are a lot of money. No, where are they? Oh, here we go, webcams, great. So I'm gonna put this link in the chat. And so one way that I've been able to set up is almost every webcam you can mount on a tripod. At Adorama, I know they have a tripod that has wheels. And so what happens is you can mount your camera on a tripod, and then from there, yeah, the tripod. And then from there, if you get USB extension cables, you can order those. You can also order those from Adorama as well. So the difference between a webcam and a camera. So a webcam essentially is like a small device. It can literally fit in the palm of your hand that's connected via a USB cable that you can, essentially used as another external camera from your computer or laptop. A camera like a DSLR, which you can also use, or even a mirrorless camera, which you can also use as a webcam as well. That is for more high grade video. And the reason why I suggest that, that it is important, even if you get like, not necessarily like a massive production level camera, it's worth to get one because again, you can document your process and you can document your project as a teaching artist. I think one of the things Milando and I both kind of like put our hands to and swear by, we believe in like definitely doing, you know, as much as we can for ourselves and like as many skills as we can, you know, and only because it's like, it's literally helped us advocate for ourselves when someone's like, oh, does that need to be done? We're like, yeah, actually I can do that. And we, you know, it's allowed us to like keep eating, but in the sense that, It learned the difference between the webcam and then like a regular camera because they're both beneficial. I would say the webcam for like studio, you can like really create like the virtual teaching Zoom experience you want, and it gives you a malleable space to do that. And then a camera allows you to then leave and like document externally in a more and high quality way.
And depending on the type of camera that you have, the type of digital camera that you have, you could also potentially convert that to a webcam. So for example, I'm on a Sony a7 III, which is a decently pricey camera, but Sony created a new app where you can actually plug it into your laptop. So I don't know if you can tell, but that's why like my image doesn't have a lot of like noise or pixelation compared to a webcam or a laptop cam. And I have a brand new MacBook laptop, but doing it from like an actual camera, it creates for like a much more flawless visual experience. And I literally only figured out how to do it like a week ago. So, you know, I'm learning the digital stuff as I go along as well.
And then as well, so like cameras are much more for like film level, but then camcorder, like there are amazing camcorders as well. So I also put the link to camcorders. I think those are also, they're quite durable. They're easily portable, and you don't need as much skill set as far as learning how to operate lens and stuff like that. But they, you know, you can shoot, they now shoot at incredibly high resolution and give you an amazing product as well to work with. And yeah, so.
All right. Well, I think that brings us to the end of our time. So I'm just going to say once again, thank you, Andre and Milando, so, so much for this time and sharing your expertise. And it's been invaluable. So thank you. And I know, Andre, you've shared most of this already, but if you have, either of you have any social media handles, links, or contact information that you want to share, you can drop it in the chat. I'm just going to remind everybody that this chat will be emailed to you. I'll also create a resource list with all of these links that is a little bit more organized for you to navigate through. And this session has been recorded, and it will also, a link to this presentation will be sent to you within a week, I would say. So look out in your email for that. And if you don't mind, everyone on the call, taking a couple of minutes after the workshop to complete a series survey. I'm just posting the link in the chat right now. If you don't mind taking a couple minutes to fill that out, we really appreciate it, and it helps us evaluate our virtual events and influences our future programming. So if you did enjoy today's workshop, please consider making a donation or becoming a member of the New York City Arts and Education Roundtable. Roundtable members support our ability to provide direct advocacy on behalf of the arts education field. We provide quality professional development programming and resource sharing opportunities as well. So for more information on the benefits of membership and to join our rosters or to make a donation, you can follow either of these links in the chat as well. Now, if you are experiencing a financial barrier to becoming a Roundtable member due to the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic, please just reach out to me. My name is Kinsey Keck. I am the programming and membership manager here, and we can discuss a discounted membership rate for yourself or for your organization. So there's my email address in the chat. Please be sure to tune in next week as Teaching Artist Tuesdays continues on Tuesday, November 24th from 4 to 5:30 p.m. again. Join us for Grant Writing and Nonprofit Funding 101. There's a link to the chat there. If you haven't registered for that, you can do it right there. In addition, the Roundtable is continuing to host our race-based affinity groups to support actively dismantling the systems of racial oppression in our field and beyond. The next set of meetings will take place December 1st through 3rd. So for more information and to sign up, you can follow the link that I just popped in the chat. And I think that's it. So we're going to leave the call open for another minute if you want to save anything from the chat, but just remember it will come to your email inbox from me anyway. And yes, thank you all for being here. And thank you, Milando and Andre. We really appreciate it.
A pleasure.
Thank you so much, everybody.
Take care, y'all.
Hey, Eleanor, good to see you.
The same survey link. Hey, what's up? How you doing?
It is the same survey from last week, if you were there last week, but you can fill it out again about this session. We're just trying to get it out there as much as we can.
Not let me, so just FYI.
Oh no, okay, thanks for letting me know.
Totally.
All righty, I'm gonna go ahead and end this meeting. Everybody have a great evening. Thank you so much.